Thank you so much. That film, what an incredible opportunity. And we were just talking before that you are locked and loaded, but still in post. Tell us about where you are in the project and where you are headed.
The sound guy didn't like one bit of music that's in a certain place, so that just has to change, and that's about it. And then just a few more vocal tweaks. But when you work with five people, nothing's ever done, so. I'm completely happy, but no one seems to care.
So I have a couple questions. Let's start broad and general. Could you tell us a little bit about how you started to assemble that archive? The KQED footage, the audio recordings, how did you find your speaking subjects?
The lady Amara Tabor Smith, the woman, she had the purple hair or whatever, and she was with the blue background. She was the one that, I was 13 in class. I had started dancing with her around 2012. My dance company had made this film called Free Jazz. It was Brontez Purnell Dance Company's Free Jazz. It was kind of like this black and white film dance piece. And I was friends with her brother. Her brother owns the oldest independent art collective in San Francisco called The Luggage Store. I was doing some performances over there, and I showed her Free Jazz. And she, her brother was like, "You have to meet my sister Amara." And Amara saw it and was like, oh my God, like, that reminds me of it. I gotta meet this kid. So I started working with her, and that's right before she was mounting the Flat Hour dance performance piece. And I didn't really know anything about like mock, you know. It's funny about like an obscured history. For an obscured history, they're actually like, because archive is pretty vast. Like there was a lot of stuff to choose from. The original, the KQED footage is from 1968. And that's actually the writer's workshop. He was part of the Black Actors Guild in San Francisco in the late 60s, which Danny Glover was also a part of. I think Whoopi Goldberg also, someone told me that, but I'm not sure. So he was in the scene, you know. And so we just went to license it because offhandedly, there was the, what's that dude's name? Is it Robert Altman or it's Robert Altman? Yeah, like some of that KQED footage is in the Robert Altman documentary, and Amara had seen it and she showed me a snippet of it and she's like, "I don't know where that footage is, but you have to find it." So I just went digging through a bunch of archives and they eventually said it was on KQED in 1978, so I had to find this company in New York that owned it and lease it, so.
Amazing. I kept thinking about Marlon Riggs the whole time, and knowing that Ed Mock, you know, died in 86, and thinking about how Tones Untied comes out in 89, and other black gay performance artists who are thinking and working in documentary.
Amara is next door neighbors with Marlon Riggs's partner at the time. So I actually had met Marlon Riggs's partner several times at some of Amara's parties. It's funny because I'm from Alabama originally, but I didn't move to the Bay Area until 2002. My grandmother's brother was a blues musician who came out there in the late 60s, and he started this club called Eli's Mile High. And Marlon Riggs' second film was about my uncle's old blues club that I actually live three blocks down the street and my band performs at.
Wow. That's incredible. And I mean, it makes me think about the legacy of people who are making work that are hybrid performance meets documentary meets community activist texts. And I feel like Ed Mock and your summary of the work here is in conversation with all of the work that Riggs is doing around the same time. Are there other people that you were thinking about who were working in dance or film that inspired or influenced your making of this? Stylistically or otherwise?
Stylistically. No, I'm number one.
I have many more questions, but let's open it up to the room. Questions for Thomas.
Okay. How are you?
Hi.
First off, I love you a lot. So
but this was mad important, right? And so I think so a couple things came to mind. I was wondering, like, you recreate the dances. So was he scripting? I know there's like a dance script that you can use. I've never learned it, but like you can write down moves. So how are you recreating that?
It was like very open-ended. It wasn't like we didn't strictly try to like, we were trying to recreate the feeling, and we would take dance phrases and like kind of remix them. And plus we thought that was more important because he was an improvisational like performer. So I thought it would just be more for that. Plus it was like so much of the footage was like so, the original footage was so grainy, it was shot. Like it's all at, there's this place called the Museum of Performance and Design in San Francisco. And so a lot of his archives are there, but like some of them are still on beta tape. So there was stuff we never even got to see really, because we couldn't afford a converter to get them off of beta. So we had to use whatever people had already like converted. So it was kind of just, you know, like that.
So did you do it based on the visual archives you had access to? That was what the recreation was inspired by?
Yeah, totally. And also what we could see of them. Like, so like, I guess, and Amara explains it perfectly. She was like, listen, it was the early 80s. If you could just get the camera there, like you were doing really good. But like sometimes they forget that like you have to light black people. Like you really have to light us. So some of that was hard, and some of it was a little, there was way more archives than that, but some of it was just like way too grainy to even put in the film because there was like no real way to even boost it, so.
Did you have a second part to your question that you wanted to add?
I have lots of questions, but I don't want to be like,
okay.
No.
You can have lots of questions, but
it was like, I wanted to talk about like an idea of race history and the importance of that in black, queer, gay, like gay male culture currently, and like how you were navigating. Like you have this phrase in the film where you're like, I felt like I had wings, right? Suddenly when you knew this knowledge that you survived before you had pre-existed, that there's an ancestry to it. And so I guess I'm wondering, what are your hopes for the film to do that now, right? Because we both have it in it now, and so
I feel like there's totally like this crazy missing link for just like kind of like black fucking queer weirdos. If you're black and queer and like you're not into like drag race or you're not voguing all the time, they do not care about you. Seriously, like that's like how you get funded. But like what about this man had like total access to like, also they didn't talk about like his like investment in like, I don't know, Merce Cunningham chance like practices. Anna Halprin, who I didn't get to interview her. I take Anna Halprin classes, but like she's like, you know, like 97, so she's kind of like, it's hard, but like the scene that she invented, you know, like he was like completely a part of that. We don't have access to that. You know what I'm saying? Like anytime you're a black body on stage, you better be like this polished, crazy hip hop dancer doing Vogue, or like you just can't be a weirdo. For me, like the documentation of his practice was the missing link between like all of that, you know? So I felt like that was super important. I also felt like, it's also weird, like just, I don't know, like a bunch of just like crazy Bay Area weirdos from like the 60s and 70s, like it is so hard to get all of them together. Like, so you think that we're all like these young artists who just like flake all the time because we're young. It's like, nah, they do it too. But what I thought was really funny was the part of like who got to narrate Ed's death song, because it's Cecilia Martin, right? She runs a dance company in New York and has done it for years. And she was like, and I remember the last song Ed ever listened to was A Tisk and a Task and I'll be off my yellow basket. But then Amara was like, I remember the last song was like, what was it? Like, When You're Gone by Ella Fitzgerald. And then the third person was like, I don't know, it was like Louie Louie or something. And I'm like, well, whose version gets to exist for all this? And Cecilia seemed the most convinced. And so we had to use her. So.
memory was beautiful enough, it got to live on.
I'm sure they were like listening to the jazz station. I'm sure all three of those songs played. It's all kind of true.
Documentary.
It's documentary.
Thank you for this. There was a phrase that you said that like it's important to know your history and it's important to know the present so you can make informed guesses about the future. And I'm just wondering, like, in finding Ed or in finding this missing link for you, how does that is this sort of historical process a part of your artistic like endeavor, and like how does that maybe inform it?
It's just nice to know that you're not fucking alone and that you're not fucking crazy and that you're not pulling it all out of your ass. And plus that people came before us just because in my religious practice, I do a lot of work with like ancestors, elevated ancestors, but that ancestors are also people. I feel like there's spirits floating around that you don't necessarily know are there, but like they're there. Like if they're not like visible, like you can feel the pieces and the parts like hitting you now, you know? So it's just like, I felt like I just stumbled on like this like archaeological dig. I found the fucking pyramids or something when I was like, oh shit, like at Mob, like, I do that shit. I have done things like that, you know, but it's also informed by the fact that like when I was doing it, it's the first thing that I went to, but then I was doing it in the Bay, and of course Amara, his dance daughter, was the one that kind of like, you know, screwed in the light bulb completely and was just like, oh, hey, there was this dude who was my dance father, like, you and him should know each other, it was really important to me. Yes, it was really important to me in that way.
When did you go from that, you're like him, you should, that initial light bulb to, I want to make a documentary?
I had done this crazy like weird indie rock porno thing called Rock Your Love.
Yes, you did.
With this guy Travis Matthews.
Yeah.
And I was talking to Travis Matthews because I was originally gonna write a book, but then Travis was like, no one reads books, just make a documentary. And so
Travis, read my bio.
And so I was like, okay, I could probably do that. And so what was crazy is like the support in San Francisco, because it's like everyone wants to be filmmakers and everyone wants to help with stuff like that. Oh, y'all. Do y'all know kink.com?
Yes.
Okay, so what's funny is that was all, what people don't know is kink.com is mostly, those movies are mostly shot by women. And so I knew a bunch of girls at kink.com who were just kind of like, okay, can we have something on our resume that's not porn? Oh, Brontez, you have a documentary coming up. Like, we can help with that. All the basement scenes were shot at kink.com. Most of this movie was shot at kink.com. And one of the plays called The Lab. So basically, thank you, San Francisco brutal porn industry, for helping. We actually got a lot of the equipment. Like, it helped with the equipment because we loaned cameras from there for free. It totally working with those fucking awesome fucking people. Maneko, I love you. It decreased the cost of the movie and made it just like plush and like awesome. We had so much access to that stuff.
I have a question, but I do want to say that it's beautiful the way that you showed this in a documentary, because it was beautiful to see how Ed Mock just used abstract like dance to use jazz and then hip hop and ballet all together. So from this beautiful dance, you can just express yourself. And me and Hannah and John won, but we do improv, and we've seen how improv can be incorporated with this too, which is beautiful because you can express yourself in so many ways, and I felt like this is a new, innovative way to express yourself.
Children, meet your grandmother.
Tate, how are we on time? How do you feel about that? One or two more questions? Fantastic.
Thank you so much. I was really, really interested in the moment in the film where you and a couple other people were dancing in front of a projection screen. And it read to me as one of the most intimate moments of the film because there were shots of you dancing, other people dancing, and then spliced with Ed dancing as well. And I was wondering if that was speaking to your goal of trying to situate yourself in an ancestry that can then be used for other people to look back on in the future. I was wondering how that kind of played into your larger narrative and your goal here.
Oh yeah, that was, the KQED footage was like super funny because the skinny white boy dancing in it was, was Wayne Hazzard. Wayne Hazzard, the bald white guy, is actually, he's like the head of dancers group in San Francisco. And so my company is sponsored through dancers group. He just has like a really crazy like history there. And that was like a really important piece. Also Amara, the two of them are dancing there. You probably don't know that it was them, but it was totally like them. I just thought like, oh, like how do we recreate this and kind of like this kind of weird other way. I was trying to imagine how Ed would work through the advancements of video technology these days. And so, but also that's part of like, while we were in black and white of some of it, because we were just like trying to like, I don't know, like reference the past, but just like think of like this really bright feature. So I think just that cheesy sometimes. Can you have one more?
I'm wondering about, I have a different one now, but I thought, so what is like front to back? Like you started this when, and now we're at what? Like from like you, the like seed of like, oh, you should meet your dance father from Amara, to us watching the film now, like how long?
So it was so much drama. But of course, if you do anything with a gay man, Lord rest his soul, it's gonna be some drama. So I think around 2012, I started dancing with Amara. 2012, I started dancing with Amara. And she would talk about him, but it wasn't until 2013 where I was like, oh wow, like, this is a pretty vast history. I think around 2014, I started writing the grants. So from the time I started writing the grants around 2014, it's like, it was something around like $100,000 I got. Like, but then something got messed up and we needed more money for post-production. So it was actually Kathleen Hanna. That's why she's like one of the producers. Kathleen was just like, no, I love the project. It's great. We're gonna get through the funding. So she made this funding thing where like for every dollar some people donated, she would donate twice as much. And so that was got us through like the major last bill of like funding or whatever. So I think we got it done around, I think it's 2000, it's like 2000, early 2017. But by that time we had missed the deadlines for all like the major gay film festivals, so we had to wait until now to start entering in. And hopefully it's gonna go to a bunch of them.
Do you have any next screenings that we should know about?
Frameline, June 22nd, Frameline in San Francisco. And then from there, yeah, I'd really love to take it to BET.
Please join me in thanking Brontez.